Welcome to our Imaris Homeschool webinar and thank you very much for your interest. My name is Michael Malert. I am the Regional Sales Engineer for South and East Germany, Austria and Switzerland. I am located in Ulm. Today's topic is the combination of various Imaris models for efficient and flexible data analysis. In earlier parts of this webinar series, we already introduced the segmentation models that Imaris provides for image analysis, the surfaces, spots, filaments, and cells. The spots are developed for identifying the position of small puncture-like cycles in your datasets, for example for identifying vesicles or nuclei. They are not identifying the shape of the signal, but only the position, intensity and size. They are a great tool for counting objects and for analyzing their distribution. The surfaces are a mesh object that describes the shape of an object. They are not only identifying the location, but the real borders of an object. So they are the model of choice when analysis of shape, volume, area, etc. is necessary. In the example shown here, different organs of an embryo are visualized with the surface tool. The filaments are developed for the analysis of filamentous structures such as neurons or glial cells or blood vessels. They are a cylindrical model describing the length and branching of the structures. So all these three objects have their own advantages and are reporting special properties. But an analysis will get much more flexible if you are able to report in addition interactions and relationships between these structures. This is the topic of today's webinar. The first step into analysis of relationships between these structural models is done by the fourth segmentation model in Imaris, the cell model. This model is just a combination of two surface models and multiple spot models. An outer surface is describing the cell, an inner surface the nucleus, and multiple spot objects different vesicle populations. The tool is able to report inter-object statistics such as number of vesicles per cell or distance of vesicles to the nucleus, as you see color-coded in this example here. This is already a great step into inter-object analysis, but there are many cases that cannot be handled by the cell model. For example, co-localization or overlap analysis or distance of objects outside a surface. So what is needed in addition is the flexible analysis of the relationships between the main segmented objects, for example, between surfaces and spots, or between spots and filaments. But not only the analysis between two different models is necessary, it is also needed to analyze interactions between two objects of the same type, for example, surface-surface interactions or spot-spot interactions. All these kinds of analysis are possible. In addition, there is even the possibility to combine the spots with the cell model, which is already a combination model itself. The intelligent choice and combination of all these functions gives you a great toolset for image analysis in your hands. The plan for today's webinar is to show you some of these combination approaches in a live demonstration. I will cover the spot-spots combination by analyzing the distance and co-localization between two spots populations. The same I will do for surfaces, but here I will show you in addition the analysis of contact area between two surfaces. As example for spot-surface combination, I will analyze the split of spots into different surface objects. I will compare the advantage of the spot-surface combination with the spot-cell combination. Last but not least, I will show you options for the combination of filaments with spots for distance analysis. Some of the functions I will demonstrate are directly integrated into Imaris, others are embedded using our XT programming interface and combination with MATLAB. Most of these extensions are directly installed with Imaris, others are freely available for download. So as soon as your Imaris license contains the XT module, you can use all of these examples in your own research. Our first live example is the combined analysis of two different spot populations. I have here a data set in which nuclei are stained, and inside the nuclei two different alleles, one in red and one in green. The aim here is now to analyze the colocalization of these two alleles. I have already segmented the nuclei as surface object and the alleles as two different spot objects. The surface is not really needed at the moment, so therefore I am switching it off. I want to show you two different ways of analyzing the relationship between two different spot objects. The first one is directly integrated into IMARIS, and it is a distance measurement which is hidden in the spot statistics. I just can go to detailed statistics and choose a measurement which is called shortest distance to spots of the spots which are called spots green. Now for each red spot we can get a measurement about how far away is the closest green spot. As always in IMARIS I just can pick a statistic and then the correlating spot is highlighted here in the 3D view, or the other way around I can click on a spot and the corresponding statistic is shown here. So for example this red spot is 0.412 micrometers away from the next green spot. This is a very powerful tool for getting direct information about how far away one spot of one population is from the closest spot from the other population. However, in this case we want to go even a step further and want to perform a colocalization analysis. For this goal I want to use an IMARIS extension. The extensions that I've written for spots are all collected in the Tools tab of the Spots object. Here we find an extension which is called Colocalize Spots. Just by clicking on the extension I am starting it, and after some seconds there will be shown an interface that is presented by MATLAB. The interface lists the spots that we have segmented in the dataset, and we can choose which spots objects we want to colocalize. So in this case we want to colocalize the spots red with the spots green. I just select both of them and click on OK. The idea of this extension is that spots that are closer to each other than a given value would be considered as being colocalized. So in this step we can enter the threshold for the distance of spots in order to decide if they are colocalized or not. I will choose here a distance of 0.3. The output of this extension is a new folder for the spot objects. In this folder we find now four different spot populations. The first one are the red spots which are colocated, the second ones are the red spots which are not colocated, the third ones are the green spots which are colocated, and the fourth ones are the green spots which are not colocated. So we can now for example switch off all spots which are not colocated. So now we see in the data set only the colocalized spots, which are spots that are closer to each other than 0.3 micrometers. The non-colocalized spots we can of course also show individually, and you will see that they are not overlapping with each other or are more far away than 0.3 micrometers. So this is a very nice tool, for example, for counting the colocated spots, which I can do by just going to the red colocated spots, going to the statistics tab and showing the overall number of colocalized red spots. So in this case we have 5 colocated red spots and also 5 colocated green spots. And I am showing now only the colocated spots inside the segmented nuclei. So this is a very powerful tool for colocalization analysis of spot-like structures. The next example is about interaction between two different surface objects. I have here a data set in which vessels are already segmented at the surface, and we have also some cells that are around these vessels, and we are interested in the distance of these cells to the vessels. First of all, we have to segment also these cells as a surface. We have covered the wizard for the surface segmentation already in earlier parts of this webinar series, therefore I will for now go quite fast through the wizard without too many of explanations. I only want to mention one important step. In the first step of the wizard, we have here an option which is called shortest distance calculation. This option should now be switched on because we want to calculate the distance between two different surface objects. So I just go to the next step, choose the green channel for the segmentation, and here I will use more or less the standard settings. In step 3 of the wizard, it is important to activate the split touching objects functionality because some of the objects are coming so close together that they are not split automatically from each other. So therefore I will use here this functionality in order to use a seed point segmentation for splitting of these objects. I use seed points of around 6.5 micrometers here and go to the next step. Now I have to make sure that in all cells one of these points is located, which looks quite good with the settings I have now, so I just can go to the next step. In which I just add a new filter, which is called distance to image border in X and Y, in order to exclude surfaces that are too close at the image border and therefore not imaged completely. So now I am done with the segmentation and I can switch off the original channels and just visualize my surfaces, the red one for the vessels and the green one for the cells. In order to analyze the distance of the cells to the vessels, we just go to the statistics tab and choose the statistic which is called shortest distance to surface capillaries. Now we get for each of the cells the shortest distance to the capillary. For example, the cell that I have chosen now is 84.9 micrometers away from the closest capillary. So this is a powerful tool for measuring the distance of the cells to the capillaries. We can use this measurement also for statistical color coding, so we can, for example, color code our cells for the shortest distance to the capillaries, so that cells that are really close to the capillaries or even are touching the capillaries are stained in violet, and cells that are more far away are stained in red according to this color bar. But we can even do more with this statistic tool. We can, for example, use it as a filter. Let us say we are interested only in cells which are closer to the capillaries than a given value. In order to only get these cells, we just add a filter which is again using the statistic shortest distance to surface capillaries, and just set a threshold here and say we are only interested in cells that are, for example, closer than, let us say, 10 micrometers to the capillaries. These cells are now selected and stained in yellow, and we just can duplicate them to a new surface so that we are excluding now all cells that are more far away than 10 micrometers from the capillary. If we take a closer look to these cells now and going again to the statistic shortest distance to capillaries, we will see that some of the cells even have a negative value. This means that Imarus is not only measuring the distance from one surface to another surface which is lying outside the surface, but also to inside the surfaces. Surfaces which are located inside another surface get a negative value. So in order to visualize this better, I will now set the capillary surface to a transparent rendering, so that we are able to look inside the capillary. This allows us to see that some of these cells are indeed located inside the capillary. I go now back to the distance measurements on my surface, and you see that indeed the cells that have a negative value are located inside the capillary. So we can use this distance measurement tool, for example, to find the cells that are completely covered by the capillary. In order to do that, I just go to the filter tab, set again my filter, which is shortest distance to surface capillaries, deactivate the lower threshold, and just set the upper threshold slightly below zero. And duplicate the selection to new surfaces. Now I get only the cells that are entirely covered by the capillary. So this is a very powerful surface-surface distance measurement tool. But we can even go a step further with the analysis and do a real surface-surface colocalization analysis. For this we have again an extension which is called surface-surface coloc. The interface of this extension presents us all surfaces that we have in our dataset, and we can choose which of these we want to colocalize. So I choose the capillaries and the surfaces 1, which are my initially segmented cells. In the next step, the extension asks if a smoothing should be performed during the analysis. The idea behind that is the following. The extension will build a new channel which is exactly where the two surfaces are overlapping. Afterwards, it will generate a surface on this new channel. No smoothing would mean that the surface will be built exactly on the pixels of the new channel. Smoothing would mean that there will be a Gauss smoothing applied before the surface is built. We will go for this second option now. Per default, the extension will suggest a smoothing factor that is the double image voxel size in X and Y. This is the same default value as is also used in our segmentation wizards for surfaces. As a result of the extension, we see now surface exactly where the two original surfaces are overlapping. So if I switching on the originally segmented cells, you will see that this new surface is exactly where the cells are overlapping with the capillaries. So as a result of the colocalization analysis, we get only the parts of the cells that are overlapping with the capillaries. But the part of the cells which is outside the capillaries is not included. So this is an additional information that you cannot get with the simple distance analysis that I have shown you before. We have now seen examples for surface-surface distance measurement and surface-surface colocalization. However, often it is also interesting to calculate the contact area between two surfaces. This is not a classical colocalization because you are not interested in how these surfaces are overlapping, but you are only interested in the contact area between the surfaces. I have here an example in which we are interested in the analysis of the coverage of this yellow structure by the magenta structure here. In order to do the analysis, I just activate one of the surfaces and go to the Tools tab, where the extensions are collected. You will find here an extension that is called Surface-Surface Contact Area. In the interface that is provided by the extension, we can in the first step select the primary surface, which is the surface that shall be covered by the other surface. So in this case, it would be our yellow surfaces. Afterwards, we have to choose the surface that is covering the other surface, our secondary surface. In this case, this is the surface magenta. Before the analysis starts, the extension gives us a feedback and asks if we really would like to calculate the amount of surfaces magenta that is in contact with surfaces yellow. Now in this example, a warning is given by the extension, telling us that the dataset has not isotropic voxels. This means that the Z size differs from the X and Y size of the voxels. Imaris will generate during the analysis a new channel and generate a new surface based on this channel. The best result for the new surface is achieved when the resolution of the channel is equally in all dimensions. Otherwise, the surface calculation would behave differently in Z than in X and Y. Therefore, Imaris suggests to resample the dataset in such a manner that the voxels get isotropic. Luckily, the extension is calculating for us the needed number of Z slices. Though I'm skipping the analysis here and go to the Edit menu, there is an entry Resample 3D. Adjust that the number of Z slices to the suggested number, which was 120. Afterwards, I can restart the analysis by starting the extension again. I choose again the surfaces yellow as primary surface and the surface magenta as secondary surface. Now the result of the extension is a new surface that is exactly at the location where the magenta structure is covering the yellow structure. The entire idea of the analysis is to get an information about which part of the yellow structure is covered by the magenta structure. This measurement is given inside the new surface contact area object. I just go to the statistics tab and to the overall statistics, and there it gives me the surface area coverage in percent. So in this case, 31.9% of the yellow surface are covered by the magenta surface. This was my last example for surface-surface interaction analysis. Let us go now to the next topic. Our next topic is the interaction between spots and surfaces and also spots and cells. I have here an example in which we see green stained cells and red stained bacteria. The bacteria are interacting with the cells and are invading the cells. Our aim is to analyze the amount of bacteria that have already penetrated the cell and also the distance of bacteria that are still not inside the cells to the corresponding cells. I have already segmented the cells as surfaces, so I will switch off the green channel for now and visualize the cells as transparent surfaces. The next step is the segmentation of the bacteria. In this segmentation wizard, I will make use of our previously introduced classification procedure. My aim is to directly classify the bacteria regarding the fact whether they are inside or outside the cells. For the segmentation, I have of course to choose the red channel, and I have to enter an estimated size of my bacteria, which is around 0.8 micrometer. So the bacteria are identified quite nicely now, and I can switch off the red channel in order to only concentrate on the segmented objects. The next step is our new classification step. Here for the classification I will use the statistic shortest distance to surfaces, which means shortest distance to our cells, and I will set the threshold slightly below zero, around minus 0.4, in order to make sure that the bacteria have completely penetrated the cells. You see now in the preview that bacteria that are inside the cells are labeled in blue, and bacteria that are outside the cells are labeled in magenta. So I'm happy with this classification and finish my wizard. So with this classification procedure, we were directly able to split our bacteria inside the wizard regarding the fact whether they are inside or outside the cells. However, so far we can still not answer the questions how many bacteria are inside an individual cell, because we don't have split them per cell, but only by the fact if they are inside or outside a cell. So our next goal is to answer the question inside which cell a specific bacterium is located. For this purpose, we have introduced a very useful extension, which is called split into surface objects. So I am now in my spots object and want to split my spots into the corresponding surface objects. The extension is just taking all spots objects and is analyzing whether they are inside a specific surface. It will generate a new folder of spot objects. Each individual spot object has only spots that are inside a specific cell. All spots that are residing inside the same cell get the same color tag. I can now interact specifically with the population of spot that is residing with inside one cell. For example, I can switch on and off the visualization of spots of a specific cell, or I can do statistics only for the spots that are residing within this specific cell. For example, in this cell, 8 bacteria are invaded. So this is a very useful surface spot combination approach in order to analyze the behavior of spots with inside a specific surface. However, we can also perform analysis for the spots that are sitting outside the cells. Therefore, I am now deactivating these split spots inside the cell and are concentrating again on all segmented spots. At the moment, they are labeled for the fact if they are located inside or outside the cells. But instead of this labeling, I can also use a color coding. Therefore, I have just to deactivate the labeling color and can activate a statistic coding. I will now color code the spots for their distance to the closest cell. Spots that are far away from the cells get a reddish color, and spots that are close or inside the cells get a blue color. This statistic can of course also be used for filtering, so I could for example filter away spots that are really close to a cell and only concentrate to spots that are far away. So let us do this for a moment. I just activate the filter at the distance to surface threshold and say we would, for example, like to only concentrate on bacteria that are more far away from the cells than, let us say, 10 micrometers. I could duplicate this to a new spot selection and now I'm only visualizing the spots that are far away from the cells. So you see, we have a lot of flexibility with this distance measurement tool, but there is one question that we cannot answer with this tool. While we can get answers to the question how far away is a spot from a cell, we cannot directly say which cell is the closest cell to this spot. For example, if we get a measurement for this spot here that it has a specific distance to the next cell, it is not really obvious to us if the closest cell is this cell here on the top or if it is this cell. This is just the nature of how the measurement is implemented here in IMARIS. We have a distance map, but we cannot directly decide which one is the closest object. So in order to answer this question, I would like to introduce to you the interactions between spots and the IMARIS cells object. But before I do that, I just will clean my dataset a little bit and just delete these spots inside surface objects because we don't need them at the moment and I just want to have a more clean interface here. As you remember, we have additionally to the surfaces and the spot segmentation model in IMARIS also the cell module, which is a combination of surfaces and spots. I add now a cell into my scene here and I get the creation wizard for the cells presented, but for now I don't want to use this segmentation wizard because what I just want to do is I would like to transfer or to translate my surface objects into a cells object. This is a really easy procedure. I just need to click here on the button Import Surfaces to Cell. Now I get an interface and it asks me which surface I would like to import as a cell. So this is easy to decide here because we only have one surface object. So I take my surfaces describing the cells and import them as cell. So what we now get is a cells object that has exactly the same structure as my original surfaces object. So these are my cells and these are my original surfaces. I can now in addition also import my spots objects as vesicles into the cell objects. This is done again in the Edit tab. I just import spots to vesicles. You will see now that IMARIS only imported the spots to the cells which are residing inside the cell, but not spots that are outside the cell. This is just the nature of our IMARIS cell model. It just has an outer surface, which is our cell, and inside this outer surface, spots can be residing. But all the spots that are outside this surface will be deleted because they are not fitting to our model. But what I would like to do now is to analyze the distance of spots that are outside the cells to the cell and additionally to answer the question which cell is the closest cell. And exactly for this question we have an extension implemented for cells which you can either activate from the cells object or also from the spots object. This extension is called vesicle outside cell. This name of the extension implicates that the extension is analyzing spots that are residing outside the cell but is treating them similar as our classic vesicle model inside the cells. So it will analyze the distance of the vesicle to the cell surface and it will also tell you which cell is the closest cell to this spot. So the result of this extension is just the addition of new statistics to the spots object. These new statistics are called nearest cell distance and nearest cell ID. The nearest cell distance is giving us the distance to the closest cell. For example, for this bacterium, the closest cell is 9.41 micrometer away. And the nearest cell ID gives us the ID of the closest cell. So each of these cells has a specific ID by which it can be identified. In order to get a combined table in which both of these statistics can be exported, I will now use our Vantage plotting tool. Here I will set up a 2D scatter plot, will only inspect our spots, and I will compare the nearest cell ID with the nearest cell distance. So this plot shows now for each individual cell the distances of the corresponding bacteria. This is also available as a list that can be exported to Excel and which is sortable. So I could, for example, sort this list for the cell ID and inspect the nearest cell distance for each individual spot. The export button brings all these statistics to Excel or to comma-separated values. So we have now seen how we can sort bacteria inside the cells to the specific cell and also bacteria outside the cells to the specific cells. For the cell model, I just shortly want to mention that the cell object itself, of course, is also able to report about number of bacteria per cell. So we have here a statistic that is called cell number of vesicles. So for each individual cell, you can also here report the number of contained bacteria. For example, this cell contains 13 bacteria. So I have shown you now two different approaches for sorting the bacteria that are sitting outside the cell. One is just the distance measurement between spots and cells, and the other one between spots and surfaces. In the last step now, I would like to show you a comparison between these two methods so that you better understand the individual behaviors and advantages of the different approaches. In order to do that, I will set up a Vantage plot that is comparing the results of the two different methods. The results from the two different approaches are both saved as a statistic in the spots object. So I will now compare the nearest cell distance, which is the closest distance from the spots to the cells object, with the shortest distance from the spots to the surface objects. So you see that both statistics show the similar result. So a spot that is slightly less than 15 micrometers away from the surface is also slightly less than 15 micrometers away from the cell. Therefore, we get this bar. However, both measurements are behaving a little bit different here at the bottom of this bar. In order to understand better what is going on here, I will now activate the labeling for the spot that we have done in the segmentation. So I will label the spots to whether they are sitting inside the cell or outside the cell. Now you see that this difference is exactly appearing for the spots that are sitting inside the cells. So both measurements are behaving differently here. While the shortest distance to surfaces measurements gives negative values to spots that are inside the cells and therefore is also measuring the distance from spots that are sitting inside, the nearest cell distance measurement will give for these spots always the value 0. So this measurement is not working for spots that are sitting inside the cells, it is only applied for spots outside the cell, while this measurement gives negative values for objects that are sitting inside the cell. So we saw now examples for flexible interaction between spots and surfaces and spots and cells. The last example I would like to show you today is the interaction between filaments and spots. In this dataset, we have in the red channel a retinal ganglion cell stained, and in the green channel amacrine dendrite puncta. I have already segmented the ganglion as filament and the amacrine puncta as spots. Our aim is now to identify amacrine puncta that are in close contact to the filament. There is no direct distance measurement between spots and filaments implemented in IMARIS, so we have no statistic that would be something like shortest distance between spot and filament. However, we can again make use of very powerful extensions here. We find in the spots object an extension that is called find spots close to filaments. The extension provides two different methods for measuring the distance between the spots and the filament. The first one is a measurement between the spot center and the filament center, but it is corrected for the relative filament radius. So what it is calculating is the distance between the center of the spot and the center of the filament divided by the radius of the filament at that point. The second method is an absolute distance method, which is the distance from the spot center to the edge of the filament. So the main difference here is that the first method is using the filament center and the second method the filament edge. I will now choose the second method and measure the absolute distance between the spots and the filament. Now the extension is asking for a threshold. All spots that are closer to the filament than this threshold would be considered as being spots close to filament, and all spots that are more far away from this threshold will be considered as spots far away from the filament. I take as threshold now the 1.0 micrometers. So the output of this extension are two new spot objects. One is called amacrine dendrite puncta closer than 1 micrometer to the ganglion, and the other one is called dendrite puncta farther away than 1 micrometer to the retinal ganglion. The two spots are color-coded with different colors, and they can be switched on and off individually. Thereby, I can easily display only the spots that are far away or only the spots that are close to the filament. Additionally, I can now do statistics selectively for the individual spot classes. For example, here I find all statistics that are for the spots close to the filament, while in the other object I could observe statistics for the spots that are more far away from the filament. So we have now in overall 1,811 spots that are close to the filament, and much more spots that are far away from the filament. This tool is used really often in neurobiology, for example also for synaptical localization to the filament. So I have shown you now a specific interaction between spot object and filament object, but from the previous examples you see that there are much more specific applications for surface spot interaction. that are not available for the filament. Therefore, the last hint I want to give you today is a specific trick for getting more statistics out of the object interaction between filament and other objects. The trick I want to use here is just to translate the filament into a surface object. After this translation, you can use all the functions that I have shown you previously. The translation from filament to surface can be done via a specific extension. This extension is called create channel. It will just create a channel at the filament position. The intensity of this channel can be interpolated along the filament diameter, but you can also decide not to do it. For now, I will do that. The output of the extension is a new channel which has the same name as the filament, so in this case retinal ganglion cell. I switch off the other channels and also the filament so that we can inspect this channel. From this channel you can now easily segment a surface. I just choose the channel 4, the retinal ganglion cell channel, and don't use smoothing for now. Now you see that I get a surface object that is exactly sitting at the position of the neuronal cell. With this surface object, I can now easily do all the object interactions that I have you shown in the previous examples. So this is a nice trick for getting more flexibility also for the filament. With this hint, I want to close the live demonstration for today, and I would like to thank you for your attention. We have seen many examples today for interactions between different segmentation models in IMARIS. Some of them were integrated in IMARIS and others were done via IMARIS extensions. So you see that these extensions are giving you a lot of additional flexibility in your analysis. To answer a specific research question for your own research, it might be worth to think about to write your own extension. Therefore, I would like to recommend you our next webinar, which is How to Write Your Own IMARIS Extension. This will be a session with an IMARIS developer who will explain you how to start with programming for IMARIS XT. This webinar will be in 2 weeks on Thursday, 22nd of October. You are very welcome to join this session. Thank you again for your attention.
Thank you, Michael. That was awesome. And thank you for going over so many different aspects of IMARIS in the webinar. We do have a few questions that have come in, and I see that you've transferred over so we can see your IMARIS now. So let's get to those questions. Sorry, I'm moving stuff around on my side. One thing that I think you didn't cover that would be good for people to know is how would someone know which within the cell module, which cell is which, especially when we take that data and export it out to Excel. Can you go through that for a little bit?
Okay, yeah, thank you for that question. Yeah, so this is something that I did not really mention. So I have talked a lot about cell and surface IDs. So the trick is just that the ID is always given in the statistics. So if you go to statistics, you will always see for each cell, you will see the ID. And this can then also be exported to Excel. If you are doing exporting these statistics, it will always export it together with the ID. But what is always also nice to have is it would be nice to have the ID of such a cell or surface directly also in the image so that you can see there also directly. So what you can do here is you could select all your surfaces. So let us, for example, do that for the surfaces. So I select all my surfaces and would just add a statistic to them. Let us say we are looking for volume. And then I just can click here on this little icon, which is called Add Annotation from Selection. And now you will get an annotation about this statistic, and this will also show the cell ID. So you can directly also in the data set see which cell has which ID, so that you can directly interplay also in 3D with these IDs and now which cell is which one. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then oftentimes when all of us within the Amaris team are using the cell module, we're using images that have cells in them. But I think I wanted to make the point, I was going to ask you this question, but I think I'll just keep talking. I was going to make the point that it doesn't have to be a cell. It's the idea behind the cell module is that it creates compartments. And so compartments could be cells that have nuclei and vesicles within them, but it also could be something like a whole organ or a cluster of cells, something like that. And so just think of the cell module as helping you create compartments that you can then link the objects that are within them together. And then another question, this one for Michael, it came up in some of the questions that were asked by the attendees is, can you clarify, and just one more time, because I think I did hear you say it, but when Amaris is making these distance measurements from spots to surfaces or spots to spots, surfaces to surfaces, what is it actually using as those endpoints for those distance measurements? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a good question and also important one to know. So yeah, it is a little bit different for the surfaces and for the spots. So for the spot, it is always taking the center of the spot, because in principle, our spot model is just a location and a diameter. So that is what our spot is. So we are always looking for the location of the spot and are then measuring to the closest part of the closest surface in principle. So for surface, it will really take the outer part of the surface, which is the next one to the spot. And for the spot, it will take the center of the spot.
Yeah. Yep, exactly. Okay, and then I think I had one more. I was listening to you too much. Oh, yes. And then, sorry, now I remember. So Sonia had asked us, where can you get these extensions? And so some of them come with every single installation of Amaris. And as long as you install what's called the MATLAB compiler runtime, which is also available on our customer portal, just where in the same place where you would download Amaris, you will be able to run those extensions. However, Michael pointed out several extensions that have been created by members of our community, and so not necessarily by the Amaris engineering team, but they are super useful, as you've seen, so you might want to get your hands on those. Right now, right this minute, I would say go to your support team. And so that's either asiasupport@bitbrain.com, US support, or EU support, depending on which region you're within. So you can email them, tell them the kind of thing that you want to do or what you're interested in, and they can help you get those. Right now, we are fixing our website to be able to get these extensions back online. They were pulled down earlier in the summer. And so right this second, people are working on that. And we hope to have that back online within the next week or two. And we'll include that in the next newsletter that we send out to everyone to make sure that you know how to get to those. So that's what's going on with that. And I think that covers all of the questions that we've had today. We've answered some of them personally if they were specific. If you have any more questions for us, go ahead and email either your local salesperson or your regional support team, and we'll make sure to take care of that for you. And then Stay tuned. We do have a couple more webinars going on. Michael mentioned one of them. There'll be another one on classification, and all of those are available again from our Learning Center on our website. So thanks for joining us. Take care. Enjoy the rest of your week. And thanks again to Michael. Doing a great job.
Yeah, thank you. Goodbye. It was nice
to talk to you. Sorry. Bye.